Yes, thank you very much. As a historian, I'm very interested in the influences for the development of technology, and for me, it's no doubt that space and time play a very important role. And as an introduction, I will deal here with space because that is the title of the series, and exclude time. And concerning space, I think you can make the differentiation between physical fundamentals and cultural fundamentals. And if you would like, you can found behind that physical geography and cultural geography. And concerning the cultural fundamentals, that will be the theme of my paper. And you will discover all the points here. You will find something on society and politics and economy and values, research and development and education and training. And but in the introduction, I would like to make some remarks on the physical fundamentals, because I think they are also very important. And to start with, I think that sometimes pure distances play an important role in technological development. Take, for instance, the Japanese consumer electronic industry, which started after World War II to go abroad. And going abroad, they did this with very small and very light products like portable radios and Walkmans and Discman and so on. And among other points, that was in order to reduce the transportation costs to the United States and to Europe. Take the other point, resources. Very often you can read, and maybe that could be also a theme in our conference, that Germany has few natural resources, and therefore it is forced to compensate this by knowledge, and that Germany is a very good example for a knowledge economy. And the third point, climate. I would like to refer to the textile and papermaking industry, which need a particular temperature and a particular humidity. And today they produce this by artificial means. And these are some examples that in technological developments, also physical constraints and opportunities are important. Now I would like to start with my paper. I would like to give you some dates on my theme, on the Siemens Company in 19th century. The Siemens Company was founded as a telegraph company by Werner Siemens in 1847 in Berlin. And some years later, Werner Siemens and his family went abroad, and Werner Siemens conceived the company as a family company, and therefore he wanted to place his brothers at important positions of the company. He had, by the way, 14 sisters and brothers, and therefore had a good selection. And the most important brothers were the two here, namely William, who had the English company since 1850s, and brother Karl, who had the Russian company since 1853. Some more dates on the English company. In 1847, an English official company, Siemens & Halske, was founded in London, and it was renamed in Siemens process in 1865 and was had by William Siemens until his death in 1883. Well, my paper is on cultural differences between England and Germany. And you can see it, for instance, by a lot of conflicts which emerged since the founding of the company between the Berlin branch, the German branch, and the English branch. And that means between Werner and William. The first point was that in William's opinion, the products which were made in Germany, transported to Great Britain, were too expensive. And in his opinion, it would be cheaper to manufacture them in England. And the second point is that William Siemens designed new innovative water meters, and he made drawings and explanations which were sent to Berlin, and the water meters manufactured in Berlin. But this deed did need a lot of time, and in his opinion it would be much faster to manufacture them in Britain. And behind was, in my opinion, the difference between the German craft tradition in that time, the German craft tradition, and the British industrial tradition. And a very, very big conflict between the brothers concerned the Siemens engagement in global telegraphy. The question was how to engage in global telegraphy. In William's opinion, the company should manufacture, lay, and operate the telegraph cables. In Werner's opinion, that was too risky. Siemens should not compete with the market leaders, because that would be too risky. And at the end of the day, that meant that for Siemens, there was also only a secondary position at the cable market. And the last point was that in Werner's opinion, William should concentrate on running the Siemens company in England. However, William wanted to work additionally as an independent engineer and industrialist. And at the end, William had to accept this. These were conflicts over decades between the two brothers, between the two companies. That is only the surface of a lot of discussions which took place between the brothers. Now I would like to give you some information on William Siemens' education and training. He was born in Germany, and he visited in Germany secondary schools. And later on, he himself said that his school education in Germany was very, very poor. Nevertheless, he visited the Göttingen University, and that was only because his brother-in-law taught as a chemist at the Göttingen university. But that was a rather short visit at the university, and it was something like an introduction in scientific thinking, not an education as a physicist, for instance. And after visiting the Göttingen University, he was trained as a mechanical engineer in a very respected machine building company. And that was a training on the job. And in that time, that training on the job was a normal way of becoming engineer in Germany. In Germany, there existed also technical schools, trade schools, you can name them, but only a minority of the engineers visited the trade schools and was educated within the trade schools. Most of the engineers got a training on the job. In 1844, William Siemens went to England and stayed in England, and there he worked as civil engineer in very different fields like machinery building, textile industry, railway engineering, civil engineering, and so on and so on. And there he got that broad technological competence and this ability of problem solving that one of his brother engineers, member of the Royal Society, he wrote the first biography on William Siemens, could write. He was probably one of the best and most accomplished mechanics that ever lived. Maybe that goes a little bit too far, but it tells us something on the impressions of his contemporaries. And by that instruction, by that education, he got the competence being able to run the English Siemens Company and additionally to run an independent engineering office. I mentioned that in 1844 he decided to move to England and to stay in England. And the question was, how to become an Englishman and how to become an English professional engineer. And one very important point was that he became member in a lot of learned and professional societies in England, was what for England was an introduction into an engineering career. I will come back to that point later. He married a British woman, or to be more exactly, a Highland lady from Scotland, and he acquired the English citizenship. And I think that he profited very much from his wife concerning the language and concerning English customs. In any case, he was able, since the late 1850s, to lecture and to publish in English. And in the obituaries, which were published after his death, you can, for instance, read, his linguistic attainments were very remarkable. Accent apart, he spoke purer and more correct English and with far greater facility of expression than most Englishmen by birth. And in another journal, you can read, he was a master of the art of lucid statement in his adopted tongue. The difficult question is why did he decide to go to England and to stay in England? He only gave one lecture concerning that point, and that lecture is not very clear. But I think there were three points. And the first point was that in England, the opportunities for an engineer and industrialist in those times was much larger than in Germany in the 1840s. And the other point was that he was very friendly welcomed and accepted by his English brother engineers. And the third, that the political situation in was the political situation in Germany. William Siemens was a liberal and a Republican, and he attacked with harsh words, in particular the Prussian government and the Prussian kings. It was clear that for him the political situation in England was much more better than in Germany. Now I will turn to his professional activities. And what you can see here are his memberships in British learned and professional societies. And you can find all the important societies. You can find the Royal Society, which was the most important scientific one. You can find the Institution of Civil Engineers, which was the most important engineering one, the Institution of Mechanical Engineers, Institution of Naval Architects, the Iron and Steel Institute, Chemical Society, Society of Telegraph Engineers. And additionally, he joined the societies for promoting science, like the Society of Arms, the British Association for the Advancements of Science, the Royal Institutions, and also industry associations. And the scheme is very clear. In the 1850s, he became member of these societies. In the 1860s and 70s, he held responsible positions in these societies as president, as member of the board, as chairman of a section, and so on, and so on. And that he was an engineer of high esteem, you can see by that fact that he received after his death a window in the Westminster Abbey. And receiving a window in the Westminster Abbey, that is, I think in the British tradition, is extremely much. And later on, by the way, the window was removed, but that is another story which maybe I can tell in the discussion. Well, and William Siemens was very active in the scholarly work of the institutions. He participated in discussions and he published a lot of articles, and he published the articles in very different fields. He not only published in electrical engineering and telegraphy, which was a Siemens business, but he published also in particular in the beginning in mechanical engineering. He was a mechanical engineer, no electrical engineer. Electrical engineering didn't exist in this time. He was a mechanical engineer. And later on in metallurgy, in particular dealing with steel making. These are the number of articles which were published in the different journals. And he was responsible for a couple of innovations. What you find here is a selection of innovations, of his innovations. What is important is that when I would have given to you a full list, the ratio between failed innovations and successful innovations will be the same. That means that the number of failed innovations is far larger than the number of successful innovations. And I think that is something for innovation theory. In the Schumpeteran tradition, there are no failures at all. And when you look to the real innovation business, you find that you cannot be successful without a lot of failures. And that is included very often in economy. I don't want to go into details. I only want to mention that he was firstly successful with water meters and with regenerative furnaces, which had nothing to do with the Siemens business. And he became, in the beginning, had difficulties, financial difficulties, economic difficulties, a lot of failures. But in the since in 1850s, he became successful, and at the end of the 1850s, he became millionaire. His most important innovation was a new steelmaking process, the Siemens Martin process. He didn't get much gain from that process, which was worked out by the French company of the Martin. And but the process was important. It was for 100 years the most important process of steel making in the world. At the end of my paper, I would like to discuss why did William Siemens became such a successful engineer and industrialist. And I do this by his proficiency profile. And I think that he possessed a very, very broad engineering know-how. And that engineering know-how came firstly from his engineering training in Germany, and secondly from his broad engineering practice in England. And the next point is that he had no education in natural science, but an understanding of science. And you can see this because he tried to give a new theory of the thermodynamics of the sun. From today's viewpoint, that theory was completely false. However, he did need a lot of natural science, from chemistry, from physics, from mathematics, and from other subjects to establish this theory, this false theory. The third point is that he was a German by birth, but became Englishman by liking. And that means that he was at home in two cultures. And additionally, he spoke fluently French and Italian, and he was also familiar with other cultures. That means his intercultural competences were important for his success. And the last point is, when you regard his engagement in learned and professional societies, you will discover that he had a lot of social and communication skills. Thank you very much.